In today's video, we are going to talk about Borneo Island. I will answer all those questions related to Borneo Island. From where, what, how, to even how much budget you need to make your trip to Borneo Island. So stay tuned for more. I did my trip to Borneo Island in 2016, and whenever I told anyone that I did a trip to Borneo Island, the first question everyone asked me was, where is Borneo Island? So Borneo Island is located above Indonesia on the east coast of Malaysia and Singapore. Yes, that island which you see above Indonesia is called Borneo Island. Now the question is, what is Borneo Island? Borneo Island is world's third largest island in the world. It is the only island which is politically divided between three countries: Indonesia, Malaysia and Brunei. 70% of Borneo Island is occupied by Indonesia, whereas 25% is occupied by Malaysia and 5% is by Brunei. The landscape and wildlife of Borneo Island. Borneo Island is home to many natural species of flora, fauna. Borneo Island has one of the oldest rainforests in the world. If you wish to explore untouched beauty and unexplored island, Borneo is one such place. It is also a place where you get to see orangutan monkey and also world's largest flower, Rafflesia. Not just that, it has amazing things to witness, from nature to insects to many other species. What about climate? As it has rainforest and natural resources, the climate of Borneo Island is tropical. Hot and humid throughout the year with seasonal rainfall. But you can also experience cold weather in high altitude areas like the area of Mount Kinabalu. Now the next question is, how to get to Borneo Island? Borneo Island is actually very easily accessible via direct flights from Malaysia, Singapore and Indonesia. When we went there, we took a flight via Kuala Lumpur. Most part of Borneo is easily accessible through flight. However, the frequency of the flight is limited. If you are looking for a specific itinerary, you can refer to my itinerary in the description below, where I've covered everything in terms of where I reached by flight and where I took a roadways. The next question will come, how many days do I need to visit Borneo Island? If you wish to do more than 1 to 2 cities in Borneo Island, whether it's part of Malaysia or Indonesia, you require 7 days, as 1 or 2 days will go into reaching the island as you are going to take a stopover flight. Now I'm breaking down how I planned my holiday to Borneo Island and which part did I visit. So the first question is, which part to visit in Borneo Island, Malaysia or Indonesia? After doing an intense research, we realized that Malaysia part is the one which we will be looking at traveling, for two simple reasons: that it was easily accessible and more organized. Now Malaysia part is divided between two regions, Sabah and Sarawak. These are, you can call, two states of East Malaysia. There is also a third part called Labuan, a federal territory which is located between Sabah and Brunei country. After deciding that we will be doing the East Malaysia part of Borneo, the second question which we had to answer was, which cities to visit and what kind of experiences we want to do. Again, I had to do a lot of research, but here is the answer. One of the most unexplored place which you can think of in Sarawak region was Mulu National Park. Kota Kinabalu and Sandakan in Sabah state, we thought of not staying in Sandakan, which is the city center, but we stayed in an area which is outside Sandakan, which is called Sepilok. All these three cities has different things to experience. For example, Mulu National Park was all about caves and national park. Sandakan was all about wildlife of Borneo, whereas Kota Kinabalu is a city and had a city experience. Now, designing the routing of connecting these three cities for an itinerary is again a tough part, but we had to go through based on what are the flights available, what time the flights are landing, and accordingly we've done the routing. Now comes the question, what all activities can you do in Borneo Island? So what I've done for this video is that I'm breaking down activities as per the cities I've visited, so it makes easier for you to understand what all you can do in that particular city. And in terms of the entire itinerary and what is best in those cities is there in the description below. You can check out my blog which I published in 2016 with regards to the entire trip, giving you the photo journey of all the attractions which I'm mentioning now, apart from the entire itinerary laid out for you to decide how you want to do your trip. So in Mulu National Park, the best part of this park is that you have to do the cave visit. Some of the caves are known as the largest cave chambers in the world. Gunung Mulu National Park arranges cave visit and also safaris around the park in the night. Mullu National Park is also declared as UNESCO World Heritage Site. Some of the caves in Mullu National Park was amazing experience, and there was a one cave where we actually stayed in the evening. They have an experience which is not a guaranteed experience, is a bat flying out of the caves. So yes, in the evening you have to wait outside the cave, and at particular time all the bats flew out of the cave. It is a sight worth seeing, but unfortunately when we visited, the bats didn't come. The next day we had an entire 3-hour cave walk where they had told us many things about the cave, and we went through the cave. That was one of the amazing experiences, because those caves were not really a small caves, they were huge caves with so much of walking space. And the best part is, because the reason I said East Malaysia is organized, because they have a proper pathway which is created for one to walk throughout the cave. All the attractions you want to do in Mullu National Park can be booked at the park itself. There is a reservation counter where you can go and book any of the activities, including the cave visit and night safari. Now, second city which we visited after Mullu was Kota Kinabalu. In Kota Kinabalu, the one of the things which you can do is visit Mount Kinabalu, which is around 4000 meter high, and there are summits which you can do. We visited the Mount Kinabalu Park. It's at the start of Mount Kinabalu, and it is also a park where you get to see lot of flora in and around the national park. Apart from Mount Kinabalu Park, you can also go to Hot Spring in Ranu, which is another natural spring located next to Mount Kinabalu. We also visited a park where we got to see world's largest flower, Rafflesia. Day 2 itinerary is something very interesting, where we went from Mount Kinabalu, we went to an island called Gaia Island, where we got to discover scuba diving, and we spent evening kayaking around the mangroves. A lot of people actually come to Gaia Island just to do scuba. They have amazing marine life. Apart from these two main attractions in Kota Kinabalu, you can also spend time walking around the cities. Since it's located next to the sea, there are a lot of amazing beaches which you can visit. And if you are into seafood, then they have amazing local market where you can explore seafood. Coming to our third city, Sandakan. Sepilok is a place where you get to see Borneo wildlife. One of the activities which you can do is a visit to Kinabatang River, where you get to see pygmy elephant. Yes, pygmy is basically a small, and these are very small elephant. Yes, a full grown elephant, but a small in size. So Kinabatang River is where you can go do a cruise, and you have a chance to see not just a pygmy elephant, but you also get to see monkeys, if lucky orangutan, and also crocodile in the river. We chose to do evening river cruise because the chances of spotting pygmy elephant in evening cruises are more. Unfortunately, during our visit, we didn't get to see the pygmy elephant. But from a Sepilok region, there is another place which you can visit, Labuk Bay Proboscis Monkey Sanctuary. Proboscis monkey are also known as a Dutch monkey or a long nose monkey. The name came from their feature, which is a long nose, as you can see in the picture. But the highlight of your Borneo visit or East Malaysia visit is when you get to see orangutan. Yes, Borneo Island is the only place where you get to see orangutan in their natural habitat. In Sepilok, the reason why we chose there, because there is an orangutan rehabilitation center. These centers are not just a center where you see monkey in one place. It's actually a big forest, and they have two areas which are a feeding area where you can see them when they are giving food and orangutan comes and eat them. But apart from that, there are trails which you can walk in and around the rehabilitation center. Since orangutan comes from the ape family, they are very calm in the nature. So next to orangutan is another conservatory called Sun Bear Conservatory. There are different sections where you can see the bear. Again, it's a completely a natural place. This does not feel like zoo. Entire trip of East Malaysia was actually ended on a very high note when we went for a night safari in Rainforest Discovery Center. The things which I've seen in this night safari first time in my life was a flying squirrel, pygmy monkey, yes, the world's smallest monkey, slow loris, and viper snake. These are some of the highlights of the night safari. One of the things which we were not sure of when we were planning our trip was about food. Yes, finding a vegetarian food, because I am a complete vegetarian, and finding them in a place which is not so touristy was a challenge which we thought we will have. Thankfully, we found vegetarian food in most of the places. But if you are very specific about the food, then I suggest this, you take a packed food with you. So you must be wondering why I'm telling you to visit Borneo Island when there are so many other developed places to go. you know, the beauty of Borneo Island is that it is unexplored. Borneo Island is nothing like a regular tourist place. It has a biodiversity of the amazing sites of wildlife which cannot be found anywhere in the world and much more. Visit Borneo Island if you're looking for experience but not landmarks. Now, answering one of the tough questions, how much budget do you require to visit Borneo Island? Initially, when I planned, I thought it will be an expensive destination, but to my surprise, it was not. My entire trip, including the flight, stay, and all the attractions and food, turned out to be 1,25,000 per person. To give you a breakdown, flights from India to East Malaysia will cost you around 55,000. Approximate cost of hotel stay is around 3,000 if you're looking for a 3 to 4 star hotel. If you're looking for a cheaper accommodation, they are available, and if you're looking for an expensive accommodation, even those are available. Since it is a very unexplored place but developed place, you have a lot of local transportation available in and around the cities. What I've given you is an average pricing. If you want to do it at a lesser cost, you can still do it by planning in advance. I hope this video was useful and you can easily plan your holiday to Borneo Island. If you find the video was useful, let me know by giving me a thumbs up. If you have any questions, let me know in the comment section below. Subscribe for your weekly dose of e-travel fun.